Can I have my voice lower? Too much. I only hear myself. The echo is very strong. Sorry.
Yeah, doesn't matter. But you hear me.
Very well.
Okay. My name is Joseph. Paula, let me ask a first question. In one of your writings, you say, and I was astonished about this this sentence. You said that Beirut is the most wonderful, the most magnificent city. What is magnificent in Beirut?
The complexity is magnificent. It's multi-layered.
Yeah.
And I was also referring to the landscape in southern Lebanon,
yeah,
which were elegiac, like the Italian paintings.
Mm.
So,
but for us, especially for me, the first time we heard about Beirut was the civil war. Mm. And for me, it was a failed city. It was a disastrous city. It was a city about like a cemetery in a certain way. Yeah. So is this old Beirut the cemetery, the civil war, the end of a certain European culture in the 70s? Is this still present in Beirut?
Yeah, I think it's you can't divide them, mm, one from another. You can have civil war, cemetery, like everything,
yeah,
but still have the beauty inside the city, mm, you know, like with the smell of the food or the landscape. So, mm, it's like every time, like in every country, intervening together.
Mm. So you are, I read you're changing between Berlin and Beirut.
Between
Berlin and Beirut in a certain way.
Yes, but both are the same in a way. No?
Yeah, so this is, I thought so. What is, how can you compare Berlin and Beirut? In which way?
I'm very skeptic about comparing them because there is a precedent in comparing them,
yeah,
which is put them on the reconstruction level.
Yeah.
And this I don't want to do,
mm-hmm,
because like you can't compare the reconstruction of Beirut to the reconstruction, mm, of Berlin. And when you compare the two cities, you always come back to this kind of comparison.
Okay. Mm.
So I would like to compare them through the film of Schollendorf, you know,
mm-hmm,
it's like,
yep,
German looking at war, at the Civil War. And
yep,
I think it's one of the most beautiful films which was done on the Civil War. Not famous enough.
The falsification.
Yes, yep. Die Fälschung.
Die Fälschung, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Mm.
So I think that's a most fantastic film which went into the Civil War in a very, mm, precise way.
Mm-hmm.
So I would like to compare them through this film and not through reconstruction. So.
And within the Civil War, you lived in Beirut?
Yes, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Or fortunately, I don't know. But I was born there and grew up
and
there.
And this means in a Christian quarter or in another part,
yeah,
of the town?
Like everything in Beirut,
yeah,
nothing is simple. So
yeah.
I was born in the West Beirut, which was the Muslim, mm, part, and then moved to the Eastern part. So
yeah. And crossing the border?
Yes, of course. Mm. But keep crossing the borders, you kept crossing. The war took 20 years, as,
mm,
you know, so it was in and out. And,
mm, and is there some event which remains you as a sort of emblematic event of the Civil War for you yourself in a biographical form?
Yes, a lot.
Yeah.
I think there's many of them. One of them is a hotel, the Holiday Inn.
Yeah.
And I think I even studied architecture because, yeah, of this modern building.
And Holiday Inn, as I remember, was in the Christian part of...
No, it was on the... It was we call it the Battle of the Hotels.
Mm-hmm.
So there were a complex of hotels on the edge of the city center,
mm-hmm,
and the battles went there. And so it was like the Green Line moved around it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the first battle-like,
okay,
thing, and it stayed forever in my memory because first they were... women combatants,
mm-hmm,
the only time in the civil war in Lebanon, and the militants threw themselves, you know, the militia, sorry,
yep,
threw themselves from the upper building and it burned. So it was famous in the press.
Mm,
so I don't know, it's a bit, it stayed. as an not for its political meaning or whatever, but for its for the power of architecture. And this I find again in Berlin.
Okay, but it's very interesting because I think it's very important also for your work that architecture is immediately linked to a certain set of events. For you, architecture is not something stable, something eternal, or something only built, but it's architecture is always in a move. Events. Is this the original scene, the Holiday Inn of Beirut, for this link between architecture and events?
Yes, you're getting it very right. For me, it is this because I try to speculate that architecture circulates through events. Of course, it doesn't travel, but that events makes it circulate and makes it universal, because you can link the Holiday Inn to the hotel in India, which events were happening, and this way
you mean Mumbai?
Yes.
Okay.
So they circulate. You know, events take the architecture and make them move away. And that's the origin of it. That's exactly.
In one of your texts, I think it's the same text I cited already, you said that, for example, I hope I remember well, some case of repression in China has a special effect on the symmetry of the Frankfurter Allee in Berlin. You remember?
No, I don't know. Maybe I was. I don't know.
No, but because let me try to reconstruct it. So your thinking about architecture is a thinking of relationships. That means something happening in China can influence our view of a certain architectural point of view, for example, in Berlin. How does this work for you? So what kind of observation, what kind of reflection is your own position of observer?
There's many questions. Yeah. I don't know if I can follow. But I'm trying, it's a bit different. I don't say that an event affects when they are separate. They have to collide. So it's the collision of an event inside an architecture which makes it travel. Yeah. It's not the butterfly effect, you know.
That not at
all. Okay, so they have to collide and they become like an automat, you know. They start, it's like a small machine that starts working alone.
If you make a sort of promenade in Berlin, where would you say architecture for you is changing or transforming in this sort of reservoir of events? Where would you look to in Berlin?
I would say it's like some buildings in Friedenau, which are brick built.
Yeah.
Which was, I admire a lot the work of Mies van der Rohe, his early works on bricks. And this, I mean, I don't know enough the events. I think the problem with Berlin, you have to really know the events that happened in precisely to be able to speculate or to make them migrate, if I can say. But there is something in this architecture, in the brick architecture of Berlin, which can be moved, if I can say. It's so solid, but I mean, the thing is, I had, you know, like in the text of on Beirut, I have the internal knowledge to build it up in
to the spaces, concrete spaces.
Yes, because I lived them. Yeah. Like you, it was nice that you asked about autobiography in the back. Although the work is not autobiographical at all. But I think then I tried to link them to events which were happening in the press from Berlin. So, you know, and this is how I tried. I was a guest by the DAD, and I tried on this occasion to take events which were happening in Berlin and to collide them with architecture from Berlin. So this is different because I don't have the inside knowledge. So like the specific regional knowledge was replaced by the press. Events.
But when you lived in Beirut within the civil war, for you, I don't know which age did you have at that at the time?
Eight, nine.
Was this a religious conflict, or was this something which happens like a natural violence or something like that?
I refuse the natural violence. For me, you know, war is made by people. Yeah. It's not, I mean, I'm not in this theory of catastrophic. Yeah.
But was this a perspective of religious conflicts or religious impacts? Or
you grew up with it, like being a confessional community thing. But I think very quickly in Beirut, even if you're 12 years old, you understand that it's really not religious, because you can't trust people who have guns and who have the Virgin Mary on the machine guns. So it's like there's a, you know, you start early to see that religion and politics are very well in intervening or collide, you know, together in Lebanon. So I
When I understand you correctly, you studied architecture, then you worked as archaeologist.
Yeah, I studied art and in Beirut
in
first.
Beirut?
Yes,
and architecture, and then you worked as an.
And then I studied architecture in London, and then I came back to Beirut, and I was in a was drawing stones in downtown Beirut as an artist at that time, but it was as an archaeologist. Mm.
Where's the crossing point between archaeology, architecture, and your point of view to art?
It's an important question, difficult one. I was thinking of it very recently. I think for me, architecture and photography work together, but not archaeology. So they're different.
And why? What is
like my practice of doing a photograph is the same as doing a photo of thinking of architecture or doing even architecture. It's difficult to explain in very short, but that's like
You once said that for you memory is like a film still, for example, like a photography. So our memories is a reservoir of photographies. Is it that?
Did I say it?
Yes, you said it.
Yes, it's possible. Yeah, it's out of the context now for me, you know. But yes, one can say it. It makes me think of the film of Chris Marker. That's why I was telling you, is it me or?
Yeah. But there's a certain apology of things in the art you you made in the last year. Stones, for example, a sort of nearly fetishizing things. Is it correct?
Fetishizing or ritualizing?
Ritualizing.
More ritualizing than fetishizing.
Choose yourself.
Yeah, ritualizing.
And what does it mean to ritualize things?
Well, it's like to you know, like not to aesthetize. I mean, I have problems with aesthetizing the images, you know, like to bring them back to their scene of enunciation or where they belong to, or how to manipulate them. The manipulating of them becomes more important.
Yeah, but that means that for you, things express something. Ritualizing things means expression in a certain way. And what is the substance of this expression? So what the or the object of expression? If you are, for example, singularizing a stone of Beirut, for example,
singularizing
mean you take a thing and you take it away from its context, for example. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So what the brick or what the stone is expressing? What is the substance or object of expression?
It depends. I mean, it depends of what I wanted to
express. For example, is it history?
It's a mixture of everything, I think. Yeah, there is, of course, a call to history, in a way. Yes.
And this history would for you would be a human history, or would be a history of ideas, or history of infrastructures, or history of even forces.
Yes, it's different every time. There is, of course, this. I mean, the experience in archaeology made me very aware of, you know, myths and which are very strong in the area. Yeah. You know, so it has, of course, has power in it. But I still like this expression of Adolf Loos. I don't know if you
of other
Adolf Loos. Am I pronouncing correct? Where he says he walks in a garden, stumbles on a stone. Mm-hmm. It was a cemetery. It was architecture for him.
Yeah.
So this, for me, is a bit my, how I say, the relation to the stone is architecture rather than infrastructure in this case. So it depends, and every time on the project that I do, what I call into it.
And would you say that the impact of your art is in a certain way global or local?
Oh my God, I don't know. I hope both. I mean, I think it has both, which makes it difficult to read, maybe. But
But what does this mean? I had the impression that one idea of your art is this ability to transport. To transport yourself between Berlin yes. and Beirut, for example, to transport things from Beirut to Berlin and vice versa. What sort of traffic is this? If you define the character of traffic, if art is also an art of transportation,
I like traffic more.
Traffic, okay.
So I like it, art as traffic. I didn't. Yeah.
Yeah. But what is the effect of traffic or transportation? Is it, for example, sort of dialogue? This is a very conservative definition. Or is it a sort of confrontation? Or is it a sort of tension you create with traffic or transportation?
I think it's more attention, and it depends what I put in the luggage. If you have to choose to transport something, I don't know if it happened in your life, you have to choose to transport something, then you have to choose. And that's nice that you use the word, you know.
And your own definition you are sort of media of transportation?
No, I didn't think of my art like this, so it's not so quick in my brain, sorry. But I mean, I don't know, yeah, why not? It's. I'm the carrier of of the luggage. I take the responsibility of carrying it.
Last question, for example, once more. What is the project you like to realize and couldn't realize until now? Is there something waiting for you
yes.
between Berlin and Beirut?
No. The project I liked, I would have liked to realize that I didn't realize was a long time ago. It was a competition for the port of Beirut,
yeah?
Which was an architectural competition. That is the only competition I did in architecture. And I got the prize, but it was not built. So that was really...
Can you describe what you wanted to build?
I wanted to build like, how can I say?
But because it's very important, because the harbor is the limit between sea and land.
Yes.
And it
was a tension between the god of the sea and the god of the land.
How did it look like? How would it look like?
That was the problem why I think it wasn't built, because it was this thing that the form and the colors don't follow themselves.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm clear.
Yeah.
Like, it's not a monochrome. So
yeah.
The thing I was going up to was that the color does not follow the form.
Mm-hmm.
So it became so complicated to defend. So here it went. But I still would like to develop this idea how the color and the form don't coincide as we think they do.
In this project, or
yes, in this project.
You're still waiting to realize it.
No, I'm not waiting. I just you asked me, and I answered spontaneously.
Okay.
What was the mischance?
So thank you very much.
Thank you.